starting a brand new series entitled Heroes. And we are talking about Hebrews chapter 11, which is the hall of faith or the heroes of legendary faith that we find in the Bible. Boy, it's a little bit different being on a shorter stage. If you don't notice, if you've been gone for a couple weeks, we had a few changes. You missed us meeting in the tent out there and coming in here. What we've done is we've leveled the floor in half. And I tell you, it has been great to see all the people who have volunteered. Wise Construction did so much work. They volunteered all their labor. The guy who came and poured the concrete, he did it for nothing. He just paid for the concrete. Now we're able to have potlucks and gatherings and Thanksgiving dinners and stuff right here in this place. So instead of building another building, we created a multi-purpose building in here. And our chairs are on back order. So thank you for bringing your lounge chairs. You guys, how many of you are real comfortable here today? Some of you like that. Say, forget the chairs. We want to bring our lounge chairs. Some people want to bring their umbrellas or fruity drinks. I threw the line right there. So anyway, but it is awesome to be in the house of the Lord where we have the freedom to worship Him and to learn more about Him. Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to look at verses 32 to 35. And it says this. And what more shall I say, or time will fail me, if I tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, and Samuel, and the prophets who by faith conquered kingdoms, performed acts of righteousness, obtained promises, shut the mouth of lions, quenched the power of pirates, escaped the edge of the sword, from weakness were made strong, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection, and others were tortured, not accepting their release, in order that they might obtain a better resurrection. As we look in this chapter for the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at people who have legendary faith. They are heroes in the faith because they trusted God, whether it was in small acts of righteousness or big acts. There are things that they did of faith. But let me say this, that the true test of faith is not in the big things we do, but the true test of faith is in the everyday things that we do. We are called to live an everyday type of faith. It's an everyday that we wake up and acknowledge who God is and acknowledge to do it God's way and not our way. So as we focus today, we're going to be looking at the life of David. And David lived his life in serving the purposes of God. Did you know that David is mentioned in the Bible more than 1,000 times? Next to Jesus, he is mentioned the most. And we see here that the people of Israel called David a king. Some called him a warrior. Some called him a giant slayer. But heaven's most commonly called him servant. What does it mean to be a servant? When I say that you should be a servant, what do you think of? Stacking chairs. Volunteering for something. Well, that's a part of it, but there is something greater, and what it means to be a servant of the Lord is basically this. One who will carry out God's purpose. If you can write that out somewhere on your outline. And if you get nothing else, get that. To be a servant of the Most High God is one who will carry out God's purpose in your life. Let me say this, you've heard me say it often, that God has a purpose and a plan for each and every person in this place. We are the church called the body of Christ. Each of us have an important role to play in the body of Christ. My role as a pastor is no more important than your role. Just like in a body, there's no function in a body that's more important than another. There is to some extent, but you know what? If you miss your little baby pinky, you still miss it, right? It's important to your body. If your heart's not working right, your whole body knows it. And so the part of the body is important, but each of us have a purpose and a plan to fulfill. And I want to look at David's life and what it says about him in Ezekiel 34:23, and it's on your outline or on the screen this morning, and it says this: "Then I will set over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will feed them. He will feed them himself and be their shepherd." Would you underline "my servant David"? We see that David was one who lived his life in the presence of the Lord. He lived his life to fulfill his purpose. And in Acts 13:36, it says this: "For David, after he had served the purposes of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid among his fathers and underwent decay." In other words, David lived his life, he fulfilled his purpose, and he went on to be with the Lord. Wouldn't that be, wouldn't you want that said about him? Brian fulfilled the purposes of the Lord, and he went on to be with the Lord. And you put your name in there. Because one of the most important things we do in life is not accumulate a bunch of stuff for ourselves, but that we fulfill the purposes of God in our life. The important thing to know that David recognized that we function best when we operate in the way that God created us to work. He created us to serve his purposes. But we often turn this around and we want God to serve our purposes. And instead of conforming to his image, we desire the Lord to fit into ours. And when that happens, it all goes bad. And we must choose to remember that God is the creator and he created us. But let me tell you what happens. Some people, they come to Christ and they use the Lord like a genie. And they try to get three wishes and they pray, "Oh Lord, I need this. Lord, if you just give me this. And Lord, I really want to have a relationship with this person. Lord, if I could just have this." And you have a relationship with the Lord just to get stuff for yourself. God does not exist to fulfill our purposes, folks. How many of you know that can creep in ever so slightly? And what happens is we begin to use God for our purposes instead of fulfilling our life for God's purposes. And it gets all turned around. And so it's important to know and put things in perspective, because when we do that, everything goes better. When we start focusing on our purposes instead of God's purposes, things go bad in our lives. If you could think of this in a great big circle in our lives, we have our lives. And there is a throne in our lives. Now, we are to put God on the very throne of our lives. But what happens a lot of times is we have God in the picture, but he's not on the throne. He's somewhere in our lives, but he's not sitting where he should be. He's kind of off to the side. And we replace God with self, and we put self on the throne. And we become the center of our universe. And the whole world revolves around us. And when that begins to happen, our lives can go awry. Because it's not meant to be that way. God is the one who's meant to be on the throne, not ourselves. And so, I want to talk about three points this morning. That we are created to serve the purposes of God. And some of these, as I was going through it, it seems like it sounds so simple, but it's really the crux of our faith. If you write this down under number one, the very first one, is God is the creator and we are the created. God is the creator and we are the created. It says this in Acts 17:28, "For in him we live, we move, and we have our being." That means without God, folks, we would not exist. And we must remember that God is the creator of all things. Think about the power of God, that by his words, he created things in existence. "Let there be light," and there was. The power of God is so great. The awesomeness of God is so huge. huge. We can't comprehend the awesomeness. We can't comprehend the glory of God, the holiness of God, the greatness of God. But yet somehow, some way, we put little measly self upon the throne, and we put God to the wayside. Remember that God is the creator and we are the created. We need to put those in perspective in our lives. He created physical laws. He created spiritual laws. He created gravity, inertia, light, aerodynamics. He controls the spiritual laws, the laws of relationship, the laws of blessing, the laws of curse. It says in Deuteronomy 30:19, I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, the blessing and the curse. So choose life in order that you may live, you and your descendants. Would you underline the word choose? It is great that God gives us the ability to choose. We can choose to cooperate with the laws that He has fashioned, or we can defy them and suffer the consequences. We will either embrace the purposes of God, or we will serve the Lord, or we can reject the Lord. His purposes are to serve Him, or we can serve ourselves. If we function according to God's plan and obey His laws and commands, we will serve the purposes of God. The Lord gives us the freedom of choice. And number two, if you'd write this down, we must choose whom we will serve. We must choose whom we will serve. See, there's something that I must do every day. I must wake up and I pray and say, Lord, I acknowledge you as my Lord. Every day, you know, in my heart, I have to choose the Lord's ways. Because if we don't consciously choose the Lord every day, it seems like the enemy can kind of weasel his way in and self comes upon the throne. And so we must choose whom we will serve. I sang a song last time I talked about this, and I did it quite well. Just kidding, I can't sing. But it was a Bob Dylan song, and he can't sing either. But that song, he says, you're going to serve somebody. It may be the Lord, it may be the devil, but you're going to serve somebody. Isn't it true? You are going to serve somebody. I remember a while back, it was many years ago, when the Soviet Union was closed up. And they invited Billy Graham to come and to speak. And he thought he was going to do a crusade, but what they did is they put him in a room. And they had the leaders of the country, they put them on the platform, they said, we want you to tell us how you know that there is a God. And he said he wasn't quite ready for this. But he says, if you go anywhere in the world, at any given time, in different cultures, they all worshiped something. There is something built in us by the Creator that we have a desire to worship. We are called to choose to worship the Lord. Look what it says in Joshua 24:15. Joshua is speaking here and he says, if it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves today whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your father served, which are beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua was making a declaration that he was serving the Lord. And you and I, in the same way, we need to make a declaration in our lives that we are going to serve the Lord as well. David chose to be a servant, so you and I must also choose to be a servant of the living God. David's identity was seen in the public that he was a king, but his main identity rested in his service to the Lord. to appreciate this idea of servanthood. If you can imagine that you work for somebody who is a billionaire a few times over, it would take, it's almost impossible if you know the dollars to spend $1 billion. I mean, you have to really go out of your way. Some of you are nudging your wives, yeah, she goes out of the way. But anyway, you'd have to really go out of your way to insanely spend money to get rid of that large of money. When you have that much money, your money has money. But if you could just think for a moment that you were responsible and you were overseeing all the property and all the possessions of this billionaire, you are treated well, you are able to use everything that he owns, yet if someone asks for some of it, and remember now, you don't own any of it, you are merely stewarding it, your response would be that you must inquire of the master, even if the person tries to manipulate you by inflating your ego and reminding you that you are in charge of everything. And in the same way, there were moments in David's life when he needed to inquire of the Lord first. In fact, you'll read over and over in the life of David where it says, and David inquired of the Lord. And David inquired of the Lord. And David inquired of the Lord. And when David didn't inquire of the Lord, was a time when he didn't want the Lord around. Have you ever done that? Oh Lord, I really want you, but not right now, over here. So when Bathsheba was out there taking a bath, do you think David was inquiring of the Lord? He didn't want the Lord around. Come on, don't give me that glazed donut look. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? In this section right here. Come on, right? Come on, be real with me, folks. We're in church, don't lie. Isn't there times when you really don't want the Lord present with you? Too bad, he's always there. And the enemy waits for opportune moments that he will antagonize you to break free from God's restrictions. He will mock you and your need to inquire of the master. He will tempt you to make choices outside of God's purpose for your life. He will use tactics that will target your pride and trick you into thinking that when you live your life on your own terms with your own mind, that you are free. But write this on your outline. The enemy's offer of freedom is never what it seems. The enemy's offer of freedom is never what it seems. Do you remember when Jesus was fasting in the wilderness? Jesus was fasting for 40 days. That's a long time. Now, when you guys fast for 4 hours, it's kind of rough, isn't it? Some of you right now are thinking about Hometown Buffet. I hope Pastor comes soon. I want to meet the Baptist over there. You ever got a whole day without food? 3 days, 4 days. You get hungry. And as Jesus was there, it says, he fasted for 40 days, and it says that Jesus was hungry. And who shows up? How many of you know the enemy shows up when you are hungry? The enemy shows up and says to Jesus, Jesus, you're God, aren't you? If thou be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Come on, when you're hungry, doesn't bread sound really good? A little mantequilla on the bread there? Come on. That was butter for you for my 5 minutes. So Satan said to Jesus, turn these stones into bread. And I thought about all the temptations that Satan brought up to Jesus, and I'm thinking, how can that be a sin? What's the temptation of that? But if you look at all the temptations, the temptation is this. Jesus, you're the Son of God, aren't you?
Yes.
You have all the authority and the then use your authority, use your ability, use your talents, Jesus, on yourself. Turn these stones into bread that you can use it for yourself. Every temptation was trying to steal Jesus' identity, to use his authority and use it for himself. Everything, when the enemy comes and brings us, he tries to get us to use our authority, to use our ability, to use our talents for ourselves. There's some of the same temptation going on in the Catholic Church. You have the authority, don't you? Yes. Use it for yourself. You see what happens when we use our authority for self? Everything goes bad real quick. When we take God off the throne of our lives, when we put self on our throne, things go bad real quick. The enemy's offer of freedom is never what it seems. He will often whisper in our ear. In Genesis 3, 4, and 5, it says this, "And the serpent said to the woman, 'You surely will not die. For God knows that in the day that you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good from evil.'" See how he weaves a little bit of truth in that? Surely you will not die. I tell you, death is an ugly thing, isn't it? The good part is we get to go with Jesus, but that process of death is a terrible thing. Eve had no idea what was going on. It's like the enemy will whisper in somebody's ear, just take a drink, it's not going to hurt you. You see someone have to take a drink? Didn't hurt me. Hey, no problem, take another drink, didn't hurt me. Somewhere along the line, we get into bondage of those things. We get in where the enemy comes and he tries to take us. I love this illustration where Indians catch ducks. You know how Indians catch ducks? What they would do is, if you have to catch ducks with a bow and arrow, you will go hungry. So what they used to do, they would find a river where the ducks would be, and they would get these gourds or pumpkins, and they would float them down the river. And as they would float down the river, a duck would see a pumpkin, and you know what they would do? They would kind of fly away. And then they would come back. So then they take another pumpkin and they let it go down the river, and the duck would fly away, but they'd come back just a little bit quicker. And then they'd take another pumpkin and then they would flutter away and swim right back. They'd take another pumpkin and they'd go by, and the ducks would not be bothered by it. They got used to them, and the ducks came to the conclusion that pumpkins don't hurt ducks. And so a pumpkin would be floating right around, it won't even bother them. So the Indians, they would get a pumpkin and they would cut a big hole on the bottom of it, put it on their heads, and they would weigh down. True story. They'd weigh down and they would see the legs of the ducks, they would grab it. And they would catch ducks. All because pumpkins don't hurt ducks. And so what happens is we get used to things in our world, don't we? And we say, hey, pumpkins don't hurt ducks. And then the enemy can catch us and hold us in bondage. The enemy's offer of freedom is never what it seems. Jesus said these words in John 8:34. Jesus answered them and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is slave of sin." We all know people who are caught in the bondage of sin. Their intention was never to be in bondage ever. But somewhere along the line, they believed a lie that pumpkins don't hurt ducks. And we have to be aware of the enemy who tries to trick us and try to deceive us and tries to keep us in bondage so we're not in freedom of the Lord. I have the freedom, you have the freedom to say no. You and I have the freedom to leave. The Bible says that God always gives us a way of escape to get out of it. We need to take and to choose it. And then number three, last point this morning. It is far better to be a servant in God's house than in a nice kingly tent of the wicked. I love that song that we sang here this morning. It's taken from Psalm 84:10. And it says this, "For a day in your courts is better than a thousand outside. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness." The Bible says that there is sin for a season. Sin is fun for a season. Is there fun in sin? Yes. But it only lasts for a season, and then you're making small little payments every single month. Like credit cards. You want to talk about another bondage? You can buy it. You can have it now. Into 389,000 easy payments. Go ahead. You get $3,000, you make minimum payments. It will take you like 50 years to pay it off. It never seems like what it is. Matthew 5:16 says this, "Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." See, as you and I are called to be different in this world, you and I are called to be not like the rest of everyone in this world doing everything else and used to our surroundings. How many of you know it's easy to get used to your surroundings? And when you're a kid, you always say, "Well, Mom, everybody's doing it." And we kind of get sucked into that. And we can come to false conclusions in our life. Faith is an everyday type of faith. When you and I make the right decisions when nobody else is looking. When we have the right thoughts when nobody else knows, except for God. And so you and I need to live our lives like David did in the presence of the Lord, and when we don't, we get into trouble. Psalm 128:1-2 says this, "How blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his way. When you shall eat of the fruit of your hands, you will be happy, and it will be well with you." How many of you want it to be well with you? "Then you fear the Lord, and you walk in his way." Fear the Lord is not a thing that you're afraid of the Lord, but it is a healthy fear of respect. That you love and respect the Lord so much that you want to do it His way. And then the last verse this morning, it shows how the Lord protects us. It says Isaiah 54:17, "No weapon that is formed against you will prosper, and every tongue that accuses you in judgment you will condemn. This is a heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication is from me, declares the Lord." Jesus was there at creation. Jesus, who is God wrapped in flesh, who came to dwell amongst us, says this. Listen to these words. God, who is wrapped in flesh, who came to this earth, said these words, "I did not come to be served, but I came to serve, and to give my life as a ransom for many." God, who wrapped himself in flesh, who dwells among us, referred to himself as a servant of the Most High God. Jesus is the supreme example of what our identity should be. Jesus once says, "I have no will of my own. My will is not my own. My will is to do the will of him who sent me." How much more should I humble myself if the God of the universe came and humbled himself to give his life for us, that we should somehow puff ourselves up and put self on the throne instead of putting God in his rightful place on the throne of our lives? How can we do that, folks? It is because of the lies of the enemy that you and I need to take our thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. I want to close with a story of a boy who loved boats. And he one time built a beautiful boat. It was about so big. And it was beautiful. And what he wanted to do is when the rains came and the winds come, he wanted to have his little sailboat go down this stream. And so he builds a boat. He puts a keel on it, builds a nice sail, paints it, and it's beautiful. And he takes it out. There's kind of a rainy day. The wind was blowing pretty hard. He said, oh, this is a great day. So he takes the sailboat, and the sailboat is there going down the river, and it was going so fast he couldn't keep up with it. So he lost his sailboat. 2 weeks later, he was walking in front of the store, and he saw his sailboat in the window. So he goes to the owner, and he said, hey, that's my sailboat. He said, well, I'm sorry, but it costs $22. And so he left that there kind of dejected, but then he thought, hey, I can raise some money. So he went house to house and tried to get some jobs. And a few days later, he had enough money to go buy his boat. So he gave the $22. He rushed to the store. He purchased a sailboat. And the boy grabbed the boat, and he held onto it, and he hugged the boat. And he looked at it and said, from now on, I'm going to take really good care of you because I've owned you twice now. Not only did I make you, but I bought you back. Just like the little boy in this story, the Lord has taken great pleasure not only in creating us, but buying us back from the enemy. He loves us very much, and he knows everything about us, and he has a plan for our future. But first, we need to choose to be his servant. And his choice is to give us a bright future. And our choice is to serve his purposes. And I want to say this again. The definition of a servant is to serve the purposes of God. If you didn't know that, that's why you're great. That's why you're here today. Because you're a servant of the living God, and God wants to remind you that it's not about you, it's about Him. And that you're called here today to serve the purposes of God in your life. Folks, this world is not about accumulating a bunch of stuff. Those who died with the most toys still dies. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 6, or chapter 11, verse 6, I'm going to read this in closing, and it says this. Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. God is a rewarder of those who seek Him. You and I are called in this life that we would not seek our own interest, but we would seek that of the Lord. I'm going to invite Henry to come forward, and we're going to receive communion. Communion is always a great reminder, folks, that Jesus Christ came to be a servant of all. And He came to give His life for us. And we have the elements of bread is a reminder for us that His body was broken that you and I might have wholeness. That Jesus' blood was shed that we might have the forgiveness of our sins. Folks, we're reminded that it's all about God, it's not about us. Remind us about God's love, that He loved us so much that He died on the cross for us. I'm going to lead us in prayer. And after I lead us in prayer, Henry's going to sing a song, and I'm just going to invite you, after we pray, to stand, and you can go ahead and receive the bread and receive the cup. If you're here with us for the first time, and you have Jesus in your heart, and He's your Lord and Savior, we invite you to come and participate with us. Let us pray. Dear Father, we do thank you for today. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, help us to be hearers of your word, not just doers. And Lord, that we are here today, we're reminded of your word that says, as often as we do this in remembrance of you. Lord, we remember you today, that you are our God. We are your people. Lord, that your body was broken, that we might have wholeness, that your blood was shed, that we might have the remission of our sins. So, Lord, we receive it now as a symbol of receiving everything that you have for us on the cross of Calvary. In Jesus' name we pray. If you feel led, just come and receive it. If you can receive it here, take it back to your church.